you'd like to join the classes live in the masjid, then click on the link below. Inshallah, it will take you to a Telegram group that has the details of all the class timings, the dates, the days, the addresses, and the locations of the masjid. So click on that link and hopefully we'll see you there, inshallah.
When the ummah faces calamities and problems, we must look at our history, because the history it repeats. And when you look back in time, you can find solutions to fix the problems that we see today. And we can also find the reasons why we fell into these problems. So I want to take us back today to the year 360 after the Hijra of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the early generations where there was a great leader, a sultan of the Muslims. His name was Mahmud ibn Sabaktukin al-Ghaznawi. He was from a place called Ghazna, which today is modern day Afghanistan. And he was a great ruler. He used to rule with justice. At his time, the Sunnah was prevalent. The people of Bid'ah, the people of innovation, they couldn't speak. The Shia, the Mu'tazila, the Jahmiyyah, all of the groups that went against Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah, he silenced them. And he ruled with justice. In Madhab, he was a Hanafi. He followed the Madhab of Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah ta'ala. But he loved Hadith. And he followed the footsteps of the great Imam Abu Hanifa rahimullah ta'ala in placing the textual evidence first. And his Aqeedah was the Aqeedah of the Sahaba. The Sahaba who are known as the Salaf al-Salih. And also that comes under that is the likes of Abu Hanifa, Imam al-Shafi'i, Ahmed ibn Hanbal, and the likes. His Aqeedah was the Aqeedah of the Sahaba, i.e. Ahlul Sunnati wal Jama'ah. In other words, the Salaf al-Salih. And he did not allow Bid'ah to spread in his land. In fact, if a person wanted to think about drinking alcohol or music in the streets, he couldn't come anywhere near his kingdom. For he would not allow in his kingdom where he governed and he ruled anyone to come close with any such sins or even deviations. He loved the ulama, the scholars of the sunnah, and he supported them. And also he conquered many lands. It's mentioned that his conquering, this imam that is from the region today, which is known as Afghanistan, this imam, his conquest was the like of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The like of Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He conquered far. And he conquered all of that which is known as Afghanistan today. The people are Muslim there after Allah Azza wa Jal, with the permission of this great imam. He went further above and beyond the boundaries of Afghanistan to Pakistan. And the people that are Muslim in Pakistan today are after Allah Azza wa Jal, they owe it to this man, this great sultan, ruler, who spread Islam up to the region of Pakistan. He went into Punjab, he went into Sindh, he went past what is now the Pakistan border, into India, he went into New Delhi, he conquered all of those places, up into the Himalayan mountains, by the river of Yumana. His kingdom that Allah Azza wa Jal gave him from Allah's kingdom was great. And justice spread. He came to the region which is known as Pakistan today, and the Hindus were worshipping a great idol. This idol that they worshipped was called Somnath. It was called Somnath. This idol was so big that every day it would have 1,000 worshippers that would come and worship this idol. And when they would worship this idol, they used to play music for it. And they used to do pilgrimage, like we do Hajj. Their Hajj was through this idol. They would go to this idol. 300,000 of them would go. 300,000 of them would go. When he came into the region, he saw this idol. The imam said, I'm going to destroy it. I'm going to destroy the symbol of shirk. Islam is a religion of tawheed. La ilaha illallah. There is no one worthy to be worshipped in truth except for Allah Azza wa Jal. It's a religion of the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As the Salaf taught us, as the Sahaba radwanullahi alayhim ajma'in taught us, this idol I'm going to destroy it. The Hindus begged him. They said, please, this is our big God that we worship. We will give you money, so much money, leave our idol. The Muslims came to him, they said, Ya Amir, O Sultan, Mahmud, take the money. Use it for the Muslims. For the Muslim army, it will benefit. He said, Hatta, until I do istikhara ma'a Rabbi. Until I do istikhara with my Lord. He done istikhara with Allah Azza wa Jal. He counseled his Lord. He came the next morning and he said, إذا نوديت يوم القيامة أين محمود الذي كسر الصنم. He said, if it is announced on the day of judgment, where is Mahmood, the one who destroyed the idol? He said, أحب إلي أن يقال لي أين الذي ترك الصنم وأخذ المال. He said, it's more beloved for me to hear where is the one who destroyed the idol as opposed to hear where is the one who left the idol and took the wealth. He said, I'm going to destroy the symbol of shirk. So he destroyed it. And when he destroyed it, they found treasures inside of the idol, multiplied more than what they were offering them. If you leave something for the sake of Allah, Allah will replace it with something better. And that day, 50,000 Hindus tried to defend their idol, and he had an army only of 30,000, and they destroyed them. And Islam spread, and it was established. He even debated the Ahlul Bid'ah. For example, there is an Imam called Abu Bakr ibn al-Fawrak, who is one of the leading Imams of the Asha'ira, which is a group that doesn't affirm the names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? They don't affirm Allah's names and attributes. Things that Allah tells us about Himself in the Quran, they negate and they reject these attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the way the Sahaba, the Salaf, the Sahaba understood them. For example, Allah said, Ar-Rahman wa ala al-Arsh istawa. Allah Azza wa Jalla is above His throne. They would say no. So then, where is Allah? The Prophet asked this question. Hadith is in Sahih Muslim. He asked a female, a young girl, Ayn Allah, where is Allah? And she pointed to the heavens and said, Fis sama, yani, fil ulu. He is above. He is above subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet said, he said, free her, fa innaha mu'mina, because she is a believing woman. So the Prophet asked the question, where is Allah? Because Allah tells us in the Quran multiple places. So these people, they say Allah Azza wa Jal is not dakhil al-alam, He's not inside His creation, wala kharij al-alam, He's not outside His creation, la fawq al-alam, He's not above His creation, wala taht al-alam, He's not below His creation, He's not mixed within His creation, and He's not ba'ilun, He's not separated from His creation. So then, this man, Abu Bakr ibn al-Fawrak, said this in front of this great Imam, this Hanafi leader who followed the madhab of the Salaf al-Salih. He said in front of him this statement. So he said to him, Mayyiz li bayn adam wa rabbi. He said, what you just described is nothingness. He's not inside the universe, not outside the universe, not above, not mixed. Not, you've just described nothingness to me. You can't prove to me Allah exists outside your imagination. May is the al-farq, differentiate from me the difference between nothingness and my Lord. He wasn't able to answer. And it is said that he died after that debate with this great Imam, who followed the madhab of Imam Abu Hanifa, according to the aqidah of these great men, according to their creed. This is who he was. Why is it that we're discussing an example of this great man today? Because we live in a day and age where we have problems. We criticize and have problems with our leaders. That's what we say, right? It's important to mention the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, any leader, if he's a Muslim, even if he is rebellious and evil and sinning, we're not allowed to speak against him. Why? Because when you rebel against him, it creates more bloodshed. Look at Syria, even though their ruler was not a Muslim, but they didn't have the ability to go against him. Look at Yemen. Look at all of our lands, the way they're suffering because of these rebellions. The Muslims are in turmoil because we have to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's prophetic guidance. He said, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in duriba dhahrak, if the leader strikes your back, وَأُخِذَ مَالَكَ, and he takes your wealth, فَاسْمَعْ, listen to him, وَأَطِعْ, and obey him. The Prophet said it, not me. The Prophet said it. Does that make sense? So we are not allowed to rebel against our rulers or publicly criticize them. This is an innovation that the A'imma and the companions alike and the Prophet above them, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, were against. But that doesn't change the fact that we still live in a day and age where we have problems with our leaders. And something needs to be done. So how do we change our rulers? How do we have Muslim lands where we can be pleased with our rulers? We have to ask ourselves the question, which is very important first, and that is, what caused the problem in the first place? What caused the problem in the first place? Banu Israel was placed under who? Fir'aun. Fir'aun, she said, نُقَدِّرُ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ. I'm going to kill their sons. I'm going to destroy their sons. I'm going to slaughter them. I'm going to let their daughters live. He beat them, he enslaved them, he killed them. Why? Why did the Banu Israel have this evil, rebellious ruler placed over them? Allah tells in the Quran, فَاسْتَخَفَّ قَوْمَهُ فَأَطَاعُوهُ إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا قَوْمًا فَاسِقِينَ. Because they were a people who were evil. Allah said, إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا قَوْمًا فَاسِقِينَ. Fir'aun was over them because they didn't listen to Allah. They didn't listen to Allah Azza wa Jal. Imam At-Tabarani rahimahullah ta'ala in his Mu'jam, he narrates from Al-Hasan Al-Basri. He narrates from Al-Hasan Al-Basri rahimahullah ta'ala. Al-Hasan Al-Basri rahimahullah ta'ala saw the people making dua against Hajjaj ibn Yusuf. He saw the people making dua against Hajjaj ibn Yusuf. Hajjaj ibn Yusuf was a man who slaughtered 120,000 people innocently. Even when he said, when I die, when you take my janazah, kill and destroy all the houses on the way. Destroy all the houses on the way. So he was an evil ruler. So he saw the people. Al-Hasan al-Basri was a student of the companions. He said, when he saw the people making dua, he said, don't make this dua. He said, you cannot push away the punishment of Allah with your dua. You have to make tawbah to Allah. He said, I'm scared that if Allah moves Hajjaj away, he's going to place over you pigs and monkeys. He's going to place over you pigs and monkeys. I.e., you're going to have even worse than Hajjaj. The problem that he was mentioning here was the problem is not with the ruler, it's with us. It's with the ummah as large. That's why the students of the Sahaba, they used to say, أَعْمَالُكُمْ أُمَّالُكُمْ. They would say, your actions are your rulers. كَمَا تَكُونُ. The way you are, يُوَلَّ عَلَيْكُمْ. The way you are is the way your people who govern you and rule over you will be. So when we look at our rulers in the Muslim world and we are upset with them, they are a reflection of us. But we don't like to hear this because we don't like to look in the mirror. We don't like to realize the fact that we disobey Allah. We don't pray our salah. We watch films. We watch movies. We listen to music. We don't follow the sunnah. We oppose the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We don't like to look at ourselves and blame ourselves. And this is a theme in the Quran. As Allah Azza wa Jal said, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, وَكَذَلِكَ نُوَلِّي بَعْضَ الظَّالِمِينَ بَعْضًا بِمَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. And like that, we place wrongdoers, evil people over them as rulers because of what they used to do. This ayah refers to the jinn, but it also refers to the rulers, as Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said, who was the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet made dua for Allah to teach him the tafsir of the Quran. And it wasn't just him. Many a'imma said this. Many great, for example, Mansur ibn al-Aswad. He said, I asked al-A'mash, who was an imam, who was a student of the Prophet's companions. He said, I asked him. I asked Al-A'mash. About this verse. About this ayah. Allah placing the people that are oppressive over them. And he said, if the people are corrupt, the verse means, if the people are corrupt, Allah will place the most corrupt over them. And please understand, the whole ummah is suffering. This is not one country. This is not two or three. One by one, it comes to the next Muslim land, one after the other. We are all in the same problem. When are we going to wake up and follow the examples of our great imams who followed the sunnah, who eradicated shirk and wouldn't allow sins to take place? If we fix the problem in our houses individually, eventually the next rulers will come from within our houses. And if our houses are good, then the rulers that come after that, they will be good. Imam At-Turtushi rahimahullah ta'ala, in his kitab Siraj al-Muluk, he mentions a narration from Ali radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Abidat ibn Salami, he came to Ali and he said, Ali, why is it that at the time of Abu Bakr, their land was very small. They didn't have as much conquering. And the people obeyed them and the land became very wide for them, even though it was small. But at the time of Ali al-Uthman, ya Ali, he's speaking to Ali, at your time and the time of Uthman, your land is very big, but the people don't obey you. Why? He said, the reason is because Abu Bakr had people like me and Uthman under him. And me and Uthman have people like you under us. The problem is with the people. And there's a statement we should realize. A'malukum, ummalukum. My actions and your actions, they are our rulers. They are our governments. Kama takunu, the way you are. The way you are, the way I am, yuwalla alaykum, is who the rulers in charge of us would be. So now we must fix the problem. And how do we fix the problem? As Nu'aym ibn Hammad, the teacher of Imam Ahmed, said, إِذَا فَسَدَتِ الْجَمَاعَةِ, if the Muslims become corrupted, فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِمَا كَانَتْ عَلَيْهِ الْجَمَاعَةِ قَبْلَ أَن تَفْسَدْ, then it is upon you to go to the Muslims before they became corrupted. And this is talking about the Sahaba and the students of the Sahaba and their students, i.e. the Salaf al-Salih. Also Imam Malik said similar. He said, لَنْ يُصْلِحُ آخِرُ هَذِهِ الْأُمَّةِ, the late part of the Ummah, the later years of the Ummah, their problems will not be solved except how the first Ummah solved the problem. And that is the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum. Where did they get this from? From the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam himself. Where the Prophet said, تَرْجِعُونَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِكُمُ الْأَوَّلِ, go back to the beginning. Go back to the beginning. What's the beginning? Allah told us in Surah At-Tawbah, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ وَالَّذِينَ تَبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانِ. It's the companions. They were the beginning. The Sahaba, the Salaf, وَالَّذِينَ تَبَعُوهُمْ, and those who follow the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what did the companions do? When we look at the Sahaba, they were tortured, they were killed, they were oppressed. How did they change their rulers? How did they change their situation? Allah tells us in the Quran, وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَيَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he made a promise in the Quran to the companions. He said, Allah makes a promise to you. To you, who's Allah talking to? Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, and the likes. Allah makes a promise to you, the ones who have iman and do righteous actions. What is the promise? La yastakhlifannahum fil ard. Allah is going to give them strength on the earth. Allah is going to give them khilafah on the earth. Allah is going to give them authority on the earth. Kama istakhlafa alladhina min qablihim, the way he gave it to those who came before them. And then Allah said, after some parts of the verse, وَلَا يُبَدِّلَنَّهُ مِنْ بَعْدِ خَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنًا, Allah is going to change the state of fear. Allah is going to change their fear to a state of security. Do we not want security in our countries? Do we not want security in the Ummah? Do we not want Allah to give us strength? Do we not want all of our pains and our troubles to go away? This is not about what your ideology might be. This is not about what group you follow. This is just about something we all want. We all want Allah to take care of us. How? At the end of the verse, Allah told us the secret. يَعْبُدُونَنِي لَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِي شَيْئًا. You worship me alone. You don't do shirk. You don't go to shrines. You don't wear ta'weez. You worship me and no one else. عِبَادَةُ wahda, التَّوْحِيد. That was what the companions did. And the last hadith we'll mention, inshallah ta'ala, and then we'll stop on this, is the hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us, إِذَا تَبَايَعْتُمْ بِالْعِينَةِ وَأَخَذْتُمْ أَذْنَابَ الْبَقَرِ وَرَضِيتُمْ بِالزَّرْعِ وَتَرَكْتُمُ الْجِهَادِ. If you do things that the Prophet mentioned, he listed some sins, عِينَة, which is a type of riba. He mentioned some sins. If you do these things, سَلَّطَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْكُمْ ذُلًّا, Allah's going to humiliate you. All of the Muslims, whoever leave Allah's obedience and they do these sins, Allah's going to humiliate them. لَا يَنْزِعُهُ حَتَّى تَرْجِعُ إِلَى دِينِكُمْ. And Allah is not going to uplift the humiliation until we come back to our religion. Whose understanding of the religion? The Prophet said, تَرْجِعُونَ إِلَىٰ أَمْرِكُمْ الْأَوْلِ, the beginning religion. The religion of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the companions, and the tabi'een, the religion of Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Ahmed, Imam Shafi'i, Sufyan al-Thawri, and the likes, Imam al-Bukhari, Imam Muslim. These people's religion, not the religion of people, how they change the religion and interpret the religion years to come after. If we do this, Allah Azza wa Jal will take care of our affairs.
We want many things in life. But one thing that summarizes all that we want is we want good. We want goodness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran how we can all acquire goodness. Primarily in the next life, which is what really counts, right? Because what point is there if you had so much good in this world, but in the next life, you are a loser? In Surah Ali Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, لَن تَنَالُوا الْبِرَّ حَتَّى تُنْفِقُوا مِمَّا تُحِبُّونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, you will not reach goodness. You will never acquire it until you spend for the sake of Allah out of that which you love. When this ayah came down, there was a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam who owned a beautiful garden. And it was very beloved to this companion. The moment he heard this ayah, he wanted to implement it straight away, because although he had a beautiful, lovely garden, he knew that there was a greater good, which was the garden in the next life, the garden of Jannah that he wants. So he came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he gave it in the cause of Allah. Like, if you deep it for a second, when you love something, you spend money on it. You love your children, you spend money on your children. You love yourself, you spend money on yourself. But you're supposed to love Allah and Islam more than all of these things. How much have you spent in Allah's cause? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had companions there that were willing at the drop of a hat to fund whatever cause it was that was needed to be funded for the sake of Allah. And we today, in similar fashion, are reaching out to you. If we can get 100 people to give £50 at the link below, you can help us in getting closer to our next target. And if you can't give 50, give 50p. Remember what Allah said in the ayah, وَمَا تُنْفِقُوا مِنْ خَيْرٍ فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ بِهِ عَلِيمٌ. Whatever you give from good, Allah knows. You may give £50, you may give 50p, you may give 5p. But that could be the reason for you to enter paradise. With that said, please click the link below and we're going to carry on doing what we do, but we need you, with Allah's permission, to do what you need to do. That's to support the cause of Allah. Assalamu alaikum. Peace.